So, good afternoon, everybody, and particular greetings to dear Kreimer remotely for today. I would like to present a talk on classical gravity at high precision. And you see, this is work together with different people, with Andreas Meyer, with Peter Marquardt from DESY, and with Gerhard Schäfer from Jena. Now, why I'm talking on gravity, okay? This is certainly a recent work of mine, but there's also a connection to Dirk, and he has published several papers on in this field. And one is a remark on quantum gravity, yeah. I remember, 2007.
I think we should go back to the other. I want to hear this, but let's...
I'm sorry?
I think there was just a mistake that somebody had their mic on at the wrong time. So
okay.
I think you can not worry
okay,
about
it. Okay, good. I will continue. And then there was a very interesting development that with the paper not so non-renormalizable gravity. I had the chance to listen to several lectures by Dirk at Garfring at the Clay Institute during summer 2008. And that is definitely an interesting topic in getting, say, a new avenue towards this old problem, Einstein gravity can be renormalized. Now, Dirk is, of course, regularly contributing to DESY conferences, and that's already over decades. Let me just mention loops and legs, and here there is a conference photograph of a conference, special conference on QCD in Berlin, 2009. And you see him here in the Garfring, and this is an high-valued conference. Being you see Nobel laureates, actually two of them, the third was still in the airplane. And then you see the CERN Director General, and then now the new science director of CERN from January. So this is administratively and scientifically quite a lot of people came that time to Berlin. And of course, notably Dirk, and you see Francis Brown here in 2009 back. Now, Dirk did something very important in Berlin, namely creating the Kolleg für Mathematik und Physik, the KMPB, and this has been initiated by him and is an important platform for scientific exchange. And we had quite some conferences during the years, and we met at Boston, Linz, and during several workshops at Lesouch and also Bure, what he organized. And often after that, topical review books were created to cover the achievements made. So let me say we are very happy, Dirk, that we have you at Berlin, and we hope this will be the case for a longer time, and that this is very important for the scientific scene in Berlin. So let me say once again, happy birthday, and of course, many happy returns. Now let me talk now about the topic in closer terms. Let me move this here. That is very strange. The motion of two gravitating masses. So what one has for this relatively simple motion is a so-called conservative part. And during the rotation, the masses of the masses each around the other, there is also a radiation part because the gravitational waves are emitted. So we are going to consider the case of relatively low velocities. This is also the case for black hole in spiraling, that their velocities are small against the velocity of light. And the form of the orbit, of course, becomes more and more complicated when we go to higher and higher orders. And the lowest order is the Newtonian level, the usual elliptic motion, which you learn at high school. And then it starts already at 1 p.m., the movement of the perihelion, this which was first observed by Mercury, in the case of Mercury. And then we go several orders, and the state of the art is now the fifth post-Newtonian orders, with first results already on the sixth post-Newtonian order. Certainly, there are some rigorous results, namely the Schwarzschild solution. This is basically the case when a test body surrounds a very heavy mass that is known to all orders, but also there is in the next term. This is the so-called order new term, where the reduced mass is considered to be in the next order for the two particles. And there is a formalism, the self-force formalism, and that has calculated these corrections to the 21st and a half post-Newtonian order. We will take, of course, a profit of these two aspects a little bit later. And I have to say that we will not consider radiation, but a radiation-free case for the moment. And of course, one can also consider radiation, but this is not the topic of this talk. And we will study in this way the inspiraling phase, so the phase when the two massive objects that are not yet coalescing, but far enough away of each other and rotate around. So this is the scope of what I want to consider. And the whole dynamics is important, of course, for the description of the gravitational wave signals, because these parts are just a part of that and they can be measured. And the goal is at the moment to derive the Hamiltonian dynamics at this fifth post-Newtonian order. Now I show you here some pictures of the LIGO-Virgo data, and most of them show these gravitational wave signals. You see for the case of black hole mergers, and here down, we have also a picture of how it looks in these detectors when two neutron stars would merge. Now the process is as follows. You see, first of all, a starting oscillation here. This is the inspiraling phase. Then you come to the merger when these heavy objects become pretty close, and then unite into one object. This is a so-called ring down, and this is this part of the signal. So this is not what I'm going to describe at the end of the talk, but this is the basic process, how it would be seen in the detectors. There are different ways to calculate things in perturbative gravity. There is the post-Newtonian expansion. So you have here a diagram measuring R in certain units, so the dimensionless quantity and the mass ratio of these two masses. So if we go to one, then this is of course the equal mass case. And then you can go to extreme masses. This is what you do here. And here, this is the radius measured in the Newton constant times the mass you can measure this. So the post-Newtonian approach, this is what I'm will be talking about. Then by effective one-body methods, I will talk about shortly, you can make a link towards numerical relativity. This is then a non-perturbative solution. And then if you go to extremely small masses, say towards the test body, with respect to a heavy mass, you can do the self-force formalism and also get results. So, but we will do the post-Newtonian expansion in the following. Now, right after gravity was found by Einstein and partly also by Hilbert, Lorentz and Droste in 1917 calculated the first post-Newtonian correction. And that was then also repeated some 20 years later by Einstein, Infeld, and Hoffmann, this famous result. And then in the around the end of the 60s, Chandrasekhar and others have made the second post-Newtonian correction. And then there were, of course, also these radiation terms here. And then we had then the third post-Newtonian was fully understood around 2000, and 2014 and the years after, this was then the time during which the fourth post-Newtonian level has been fully understood. So this is a part which is completely finished, and not only for the unpolarized case, but also with spin effects and radiation and many more very particular things. So we will do non-relativistic effective field theory. This has been in gravity initiated by Goldberger-Rothstein, and we will follow work by Kohl and Smoltz in a little bit later, and I will guide you from path integrals to generate Feynman diagrams, of course, in that case, to the post-Newtonian Hamiltonians and observables by methods of quantum, from quantum field theory. It's not necessary to perform these calculations with these methods. It's only one way, and it's not been the first way which has been used. You will see this on a later slide. You see, most of these works have been done totally differently and achieved much earlier than these effective field theory methods. And it's even now that the effective field theory methods are a little bit behind of what can be achieved else. But it's just one method which is helpful in deriving these results, and one has to see how efficient this is in the future. Now, to go a little bit more into technical details, we consider point-like objects and will not consider spin and finite size effects in the following. Then, of course, we have to work in some gauge. So this is here the harmonic gauge in the following. We have singularity problems. Therefore, we have to choose, as in quantum field theory, the dimensional regularization. We do this in 3 - 2 epsilon dimensions. And then the action has three contributions. The Einstein-Hilbert action, you see here the Ricci scalar, then a gauge fixing term, which is tied up to the Christoffel symbol. And we see the particle term. This is the kinetic term of the black hole with the two masses here. This is the third term of the action. So why can quantum field theory methods be of help here? And that is understandable, of course. Any dynamical physical theory can be traced back to the Lagrange formalism and can be derived from the first principle of the least action. This is where all the physics comes from. And in the near to the non-relativistic limit, Einstein gravity possesses an expansion in the Newton's constant, so we can form an effective field theory. And we will do this using the path integral, because we need a good tool to generate all the Feynman rules for the individual and the diagrams. And that's the way we go. So this will lead to an associated effective field theory representation, which is not necessarily built on flat space gravitons, but we will describe the gravitation by effective fields and more complicated vertices, which I will show you a little bit later. And so order by order, new interaction vertices as known for effective field theories in general will potentially at least appear. So this approach is systematic and is perturbative and will still represent full Einstein gravity. And the key issue is to reduce all this enormous amount of terms we will need to calculate to master integrals, which is, of course, not so many. And then one has to calculate the master integrals and finally is getting to the result. So the current level are 5 loop integrals, and they partly range into, from the physics side, the 6 post-Newtonian level. Now, this effective field theory was, of course, earlier, namely as back in 1985, Caswell and Lepage already used in QCD. And you see this action will be transmuted into an effective action. And this is done representing the gravitons in terms of so-called potential gravitons, where their component k zero is just proportional to the ratio of the velocity over r, and the spatial component behaves like 1/r, and the radiation gravitons have this behavior, and those quanta are graphed together with what we call potential terms, and then we have in the tail terms we have these radiation gravitons in the Feynman rules, but I will detail this a little bit later. Now, the expansion of the action has to take place. And for that sake, we have to go to the metric and the metric tensor. And this was a parameterization by Cole and Smolkin some 10 years ago. You have in total 10 fields. This is a scalar field phi, three vector fields and six tensor fields, sigma ij, which couple in this way with the velocity to the masses which are in the game. Now, the first thing what we want to do is to calculate the potential. So we write down the potential interaction. This is minus IV here between the two big masses. And then this decomposes, of course, into the exchange of these different effective fields here. And then one has to observe what is the behavior of the temporal and the spatial modes, which I said already before. And one has to expand to the enormous depth, whatever you have to go, the corresponding propagators. Now we want to calculate a potential. So this is not just a scattering process, but it's a logarithm of a scattering process. And that is done in this way. And this is certainly so that we generate much too many Feynman diagrams, which will not contribute on the classical level. There is no pure graviton loops are allowed because they would be on the quantum level. So they would appear with the Planck's constant. Then there should not be single source corrections, or these self energies here would dress the black holes, and they can be absorbed, of course, and will not change these sources very much actually. In a negligible manner, so this is also not considered. And we will not consider source reducible diagrams. So we have to investigate things which lead usually in the time ordering to certain combinatorial factors. Now, all together, we have, for instance, these two diagrams, and then this can be graphed to that diagram, and if you put everything together, it's actually the square of this single exchange here. And so things can be nicely algorithmized in computer programs, and that's the usual way you extract potentials from scattering cross sections and also from amplitudes. And this is the way you have to do that. And then this is the final thing, and then you see you get then. If you take go to the potential, you get then this as the first term, and then the whole line, of course, up is just representing the potential disk graph. Now I said already that most of the time it was so that all the times actually the results were known derived by totally different techniques. And you see this here that only in 2004, the 1PN was done this way. Then 2008, we had 2PN, and then 3PN was 2011. 11 years later, then the original, at least more than 11 years maybe. And then there were the calculation of the static contribution to 4PN was performed in this paper. And there was a little thing to be corrected by Damour and Yaranovsky, and it took until 2019 until everything but 4PN was understood, and in 2014 already the results were served by different techniques. Now, what will be new, and this is this came within 2 days. Actually, the submission to the archive is 5 hours different only. And by two different approaches, one by Fofa, Mastrolias, Durani, Sturm, and Torres Bobadilla, and one by our group. And we had this calculation ab initio, as I described. And the other authors, they had a combinatorial argument, which is possible at odd PN. So it was possible at 5PN. And we didn't know about this, but this was very nice. And the results have fully agreed. But the static contribution is, of course, not everything. This is only the beginning of something. And still, I want to dwell on it a little bit because one can explain things very nicely in this context. Now, more generally, when we want to go to 5PN, we have to generate by a generator of Feynman diagrams, the diagrams. And if you do that, you will get an enormous amount, nearly 1 million Feynman diagrams. Then there is all kind of Lorentz algebra you have to do, and or maybe Galilean algebra if you want, because it's non-relativistic. This is done by form. And then one has to reduce the master integral. So many more things are done by form, but it's not only this, the Lorentz algebra, but the reduction to master integrals is then done by a reduction program, which is called Crusher by Marquardt and Seidel. And then we have to throw also away before a lot of diagrams because they don't contribute, and that's about 200,000 diagrams. And then you see a handful of master integrals have to be known, and they were known already in the static process, and of course calculated several times, and one can then solve the problem this way, at least for the potential terms are concerned. Now let me show you a little bit more detailed what the diagrams are. You see these five loop diagrams. This is the scalar interaction. Then you have we have tensor interactions here, and actually there is no vector interactions in the static part. They only will contribute in when we have velocity corrections. So the word on the Feynman rules. So we have here the different propagators, the tensor, the scalar, and then you have all kind of vertices. And these vertices look like simple, like in scalar electrodynamics. And then it becomes gradually more complicated. So the four-point vertex, and then you have three-point vertices, and so on. And then if you go higher and higher, you get more and more. And at the end, only the computer knows about a consistent set of Feynman rules. And of course, this is foolproof setup. So you will not have errors over there. This is all directly computed. Now, the next thing is you get topologies, and we have, of course, kind of self-energies to calculate. This is the massless, these are massless propagators, which we have, so propagators. You see here these topologies, and you have to think of all these fields. And then you do the reduction to master integrals. And the IBP reduction will then lead to only a handful of objects where you, the master integrals, you do a Laurent series, and then you get the poles, and you get the constant terms and so on. The poles you get is only of first order to this order in the post-Newtonian expansion. And you get it in the potential terms, and what we will discuss a little bit later also in the tail terms. And so you have some easier parts where the calculation is done by inserting things. And this is basically, you have to know the beta function for that. And then there is a more complicated thing. But this is also known, and the standard technologies allow to calculate those diagrams, for instance. So in a nutshell, I collect these things. So we have the beta function type solutions here, several products of beta functions. And then you have one, which is not so easy, but you see you can also calculate this, and you can, if it would be needed, you can go even higher. But at the moment it's not needed because all the poles are only one over epsilon. So you have to go to this term, and that is it. You see a logarithm of two here, but this is intermediate in the moment. And then we will see what is happening for the static potential. So you start out with Newton, then you get the static potential by the first post-Newtonian thing. And if you go to in the harmonic gauge, a very particular gauge, to 5PN, you get this. And you don't see any log two, you don't see any theta here. And but we will see pi squared or theta two a little bit later when it comes to the velocity corrections. Now, let me explain you the general case a little bit. This is of course tied up with extremely long formulae, and it would be difficult to swallow the details here. So, but I will list for the beginning, first of all, the principal steps of the calculation. So the goal is at the end in Hamiltonian. Of course, this is not what we start with. We start with the action, and therefore we get first the Lagrangian, and then one has to perform a Legendre transformation to the Hamiltonian. Before one is able to do that, one has to remove accelerations, the time derivatives of accelerations of higher order, and so on. There are particular methods where one has to be extremely careful with to build this down, but this is known in the literature how to do that, in the early literature. And what I was mainly explaining here is the so-called potential term, but there is also in the, this is the near zone description of the motion. And there is, for starting from 4 PN, also a far zone description. And so a subset of these tail terms are the so-called, at the end of the day, the non-local contributions. And there is also some local contributions in the tail terms, but most of the local contributions come from the potential term. So we will use both pictures, and it's actually needed to use them for technical, at least if you, well, I mean, there's lots of reasons why one should use both pictures, but one will turn out to be a technical point. So we will use for that sake the separation in both pictures. Now, what it turns out is both the potential corrections and the tail corrections are singular. So they have poles in 1/ε. And then one wants, of course, to remove these things and see whether there is a singularity-free situation. Of course, this is not uncommon in quantum field theory. We have much, much higher singularities in the Lagrangian and the Hamiltonian than here. And we calculate the potential terms in d dimensions. There's a reason why we have to calculate both of these quantities in d dimensions. So then we want to see what happens to the singularities, and we will gather, first of all, we have a look onto the singular and logarithmic contributions to the tail term, and add them to the potential term, and then see what is happening. And actually the singularities will not go away, and this has to do with the harmonic gauge we used, and we have to apply another canonical transformation, and then we will have a Hamiltonian which is pole free. And then we can also arrange the canonical transformation for the logarithmic term such that we meet the non-local terms which have been nicely worked out before us by Bini, Damour, and Geralico at 5 PN. And that's the way we go to have a comparison. Now in calculating H, the contribution to H tail, we use, because of this effective field theory method, the method of expansion by region, which has been initiated by Benecke and Smirnov, and later described by Janssen. And we have shown that at 5 PN, there are no overlap terms, and one can actually organize this in a very, very nice manner. And we will get as a result, as I said already, the non-local Hamiltonian. The canonical transformation makes finally the Hamiltonian pole free, which is then in slightly different coordinates, but the harmonic coordinates. And the formulae are still very large, so I won't show them here, but continue with the discussion at least for a couple of minutes. And so what we could do is that we wanted to look on the potential contributions first, and then we notice that from the tail terms we get in this this mass ratio at the first order and the second order contributions. So we, if you want to make a discussion without the tail terms, we have to restrict the discussion to nu to the zero and the powers nu to the 3 up to nu to the 5. And indeed, we could show between the result derived by Damour et al., the HEOB, physical equivalence by a canonical transformation. one should notice that not even the simplest case, namely the Schwarzschild contribution, is easily seen in these Hamiltonians or in the going back in the Feynman diagrams. So they are basically everywhere, and only you see it only in the result. And that gives you, first of all, a very good check to the whole calculation. And one is, of course, always happy if all these checks work out. And there's different other checks you can perform also. Now, there's also another method been there. There was a discussion on results by Bern on the third post-Minkowskian approximation, which is slightly different, but post-Newtonian, and you can go to 6PN. We did this, and though this is quite a part of the all the terms to 6PN, of course not the hardest part of the beginning, and this has been also confirmed by Bini, Damour, and Geralico. And that means that, of course, 5PN is covered, that we have also here a very essential test. Then it turns out that in dimensional regularization to get all the new terms is not so easy, but we have a couple of days ago found a special treatment, and now we can say more than our last preprint that we have all the order new terms right. So there is still a series of more local tail terms which contribute to order new squared, which have to be dealt with, and this is still a work in progress. And I should mention that the non-local contributions of the tail terms in 4PN and 5PN have been calculated, and we have agreement with Bini, Damour, and Geralico. This is not just the same calculation. Mm-hmm. This calculation was done in dimensional regularization. And in the logs, these non-local terms are a byproduct of that. And in course of this, we have, of course, also achieved that we get pole-free Hamiltonians. Now, let me go right away not to any Hamiltonian, but show observables, because the different approaches will lead to different Hamiltonians, and then you have to do canonical transformations to map in that. For that, you have to have local representation, so, and so on. And as the non-local contributions to all these observables are known to 5PN by now and agreeing, I can now discuss the local contribution to periastron advance, and this is the general case here. And what you see is we have actually all the terms but the new square terms. So they are not yet listed in this list. So the pi square contributions are listed, so they are known, and they also agree with the work by Damour and collaborators, and we work at the moment on the new square terms, which are just rational in this case, and to see what this will come. I can't tell you the final result on this. Now, from the general motion, you can, of course, go to the circular motion, and in the non-local terms were calculated for the circular situation. And we can add them in. This is this term and the other term, and that this is this one for periastron advance. You find them in our paper. This is not a very long expression, but I have left them open. And here you see we have two terms which we could not yet determine. This is, we work on that at the moment, but the associated terms here, the pi square terms, are there. And from what you saw on the last two slides, we can now go a step further, but Damour et al. Had already obtained, and they call their method the tutti-frutti method, because it combines a lot of knowledge on this post-Newtonian expansion and also post-Minkowskian expansion and different calculational methods to fix the different parameters, and this is very many, of the Hamiltonian. There were two constants not yet determined. Now we could determine the pi square contributions already, and we have all over agreement with this other group. And our calculation is ab initio, so we don't use any of these constraints. Our calculation is just based on effective field theory methods to get there. Now, certainly this is a not so easy part, and we have to see what the outcome of that is. And but I can't tell you more details at the moment, just that we work very hard on this calculation. Now, let me show you the fourth post-Newtonian order is also some phenomenological result. And this is a bending energy normalized here over the reduced mass. And then you see this is the Newtonian limit. Then you get 1pn, 2pn, 3pn, 4pn. And this is the test particle limit here. And this would be the range in which you get a range in which black holes merge. This is a bit wider and the smaller range where neutron stars and neutron stars would merge. This is basically here. And for the black holes, you need a bit more. And that is the Schwarzschild solution. And we expect in somewhere here in the middle, the 5pn result, but this is going to come. And then we can make a similar statement for the periastron advance. You see here this neutron star motion, and then this, the all other range is black hole, what the current sensitivity is. And then you see the whole row, and this is also here very singular. This is singular at this parameter x, 1/6, this goes to infinity. This is the Schwarzschild limit, and then you see these corrections, and we expect then the 5pn result somewhere here. And you see the convergence is not so nice if you go to higher values of x, and that will then invoke resummation and things which are already known in the literature and which Damour and collaborators have used in the past already to at lower orders to get, more stable results. So this brings me now to my conclusions, and the in spiral phase of compact binary systems is very well described by the post-Newtonian expansion. So you have velocities which are of that order, but still normalized to the light velocity of light is small against one. Effective field theory and calculational methods from quantum field theory are very effective for high post-Newtonian orders, always provided one is using intense computer algebra and suitably large computers, but that is what people do in QCD anyway, so this is not anything new. Then we have already some 1.5 years ago calculated the static gravitational potential to 5 loops. And then following with different other papers, we approached the 5pn Hamiltonian, and it has been determined up to a small set of rational terms, which is of order nu squared of this order parameter in the mass ratio. And these results are obtained performing a 5-loop calculation of nearly 200,000 Feynman diagrams with partly very complicated vertices. And the calculation has been performed ab initio, like we do that in QCD also. So higher order corrections extend the area perturbatively accessible towards the region where presently only pure numerical methods are applied, but to bridge between them, this is still, of course, another issue I don't want to go into. And then it is also something else happening I didn't talk about, namely the so-called post-Minkowskian approach, where other people are very active. For instance, Sweet Byrne and his group, then Mr. Porto and his group, and then this was also, of course, initiated by Thibaut Damour, as so many other things. And there is also very interesting work by him until very recently. And but from the full calculations, we talk about 2-loop orders. This is, of course, more difficult. And the way to 5 loops is still open, but it's technically, of course, more ambitious. So thank you very much for your attendance.
Thank you. Thank you. If you have questions, please feel free to raise your hand or just unmute yourself. So we have a question from David, I think.
Yes, I was rather surprised by the fact that your number of master integrals was less at 5 loops than at 4 loops. Is there something funny going on there?
Well, this may have to do, the table is for 5 loops. I mean, there's another table for 4 loops. This is the 4 loops in the 5 PN. See it this way.
Thank you.
It's only the static thing what is adding in then. This is, don't worry about this.
Thank you.
I have a very elementary question. Could you explain what the periastron advance means? What this is?
Well, there is this is, I mean, you know what the motion of the perihelion of the Mercurius is, right? So you have an elliptic. Normally, you have this elliptic motion, but this ellipse will in its pole will move along with that due to one PN corrections. And now we talk about even higher order corrections, but you can this motion can be measured by astronomical observations if you want. And therefore, this is an observable, and this observable you can link. I did not write down the relation to the Hamiltonian, but like the energy, the bending energy, you can relate this quantity to the Hamiltonian by a derivative of one of the Delaunay variables. So one Delaunay variable is the angular momentum. And then you have another quantity, so it depends on two of these Delaunay variables, and introduced in the 19th century. And basically, it is something where you derive the Hamiltonian. You have the first derivative of the Hamiltonian with respect to these quantities. And you get an observable description which an astronomer could measure. And that's the very point. I mean, you have to define an observable to get rid of all these gauge degrees of freedom, you know, and that's why we choose this. We could have chosen also something else.
Thank you very much. Yes, yeah, so please let's thank Johannes again for his very nice talk.